Primetime Local News, serving the Lakeland and Midwest regions.
Friday, everybody. The weekend is here, and I'm excited.
Yes.
Still some work to do, but plenty of sun to be had. Josh Ryan, Abby St. John, here to take care of things for you before you head off into Saturday, Sunday with what looks like should be a nice weekend.
Yes.
Outside chance of precipitation, and certainly outside chance of some smoke still. But it's clearing up.
Yes, which is nice. It's obviously worse elsewhere in the province, but here, you know, it cleared up nicely. There's still some lingering, and you know, that air quality statement is still in effect, but at least it was clear for today.
Yeah, and it's definitely clearing up more in the Lakeland region, particularly, which is good to see. Eric Bay is still outside enjoying that weather. He is over at Bud Miller Park for the Relay for Life.
Thanks, guys. Once again, we are back out here at Bud Miller Park. It's a beautiful Friday evening, and if you are looking for something to do, we are here because Relay for Life will be taking place here tonight. That starts at 7 o'clock tonight, but again, you can come out now, and even if you don't necessarily want to actually participate in the relay, you can, as you see, Jim, you can buy some luminaries, that is, excuse me, and again, those are on sale until 9:30 if you want to come out and check those out. So we are going to have a whole lot more coming up here in the next hour, a few different interviews coming up, but first we're going to go back into the studio where Abby will take a look at your local news.
For nearly 8 months, a stray dog by the name of Bear has wandered the streets of Lloydminster. After tireless attempts to catch the dog, a collective breath of relief comes today as Bear has officially been rescued. This video shows Bear last night after being caught near the bus depot by the canine recovery services. Bear has been on the loose since escaping owner Carol Discover, who recovered Bear from an abusive home in October, causing Bear to be much more skittish, making the catch so difficult.
And waited, you know, and that's all you can do. You can just wait. You can't approach him. You couldn't, because he spooked so easily. So he took the bait last night.
During his time loose, Bear became known around the city, with locals sending in pictures and locations in hopes to catch him. Even a Facebook page dedicated to the canine was started, all efforts that contribute to his safe recovery.
You know, I could go pay my bills at City Hall and they'd be talking about this dog. It was overwhelming, and right now still overwhelming, the people stepping up and wanting to pay the vet bills and help.
Discover has now officially signed Bear over to Canine Recovery Services, who will be getting him the necessary medical services he needs. Our local Home Depot is encouraging its shoppers to donate to support a local and nationwide cause. Customers who make a $2 donation will contribute to the Lloydminster Interval Home until the 23rd of June. The initiative is a part of Home Depot's Orange Door Project. It's aimed at preventing and ending youth homelessness in Canada. This year, they're trying to surpass the $5,000 they raised last time.
It's very important because the youth is going to be part of the society, and we need them to be acclimatized to actually look after themselves, get jobs, be part of the society. I think it's very important.
Since 2007, Home Depot has raised more than $9.5 million to help homeless youth across Canada.
Your grandkids, kids even, in an event of like being out of a job, or something like that, or you know, sometimes we have issues at home. Think of your own kids being on the street, and I'm sure they would want somebody to help them out if they couldn't.
If you don't regularly shop at Home Depot, you can still donate by going to the Interval Homes website at intervalhome.org. Earlier this month, a few Lakeland College students competed at the 2019 Alberta Provincial Skills Canada competition. The competition gives students the opportunity to show off their skills and compete in many different skills, and some Lakeland students came home with a medal.
We nominate our local apprentices through our college that come through, and then they go off to provincial skills competition. So there was 10 in all. Out of the results, we received a bronze medal in auto technology and a silver medal in auto technology. And we got 3 safety awards in esthetician, hairstyling, and auto service technologies.
Having students compete not only looks good for the students themselves, but the college, as it shows off the education they offer.
Really bodes well for the college, and it says what our instructors, the passion that they have towards what they're teaching, and the students' passion for going forward with the competitions in the Alberta Skills Provincials competition. For the students, it looks good on their resume, whether they medal or not. They're a top competitor in Alberta.
King says the medal winners' names will be put on a banner that will be hung up in the hallways of the Trade Center. And now we're going to Eric Bay, who is live at Bud Miller Park.
Once again, we are back here at Bud Miller Park, where Relay for Life is taking place here tonight. That'll be starting at 7. More people are already starting to come in, and I'm joined now by Ashley Hutchinson, who is a team captain and actually a survivor. And this is your first actual Relay for Life that you are participating in. So can you maybe talk about what made you actually want to participate here?
I chose to participate in Relay for Life because I found it was my way of giving back to the Canadian Cancer Society, because when I was sick, they helped me. So I figure I'll do what I can to give back.
And now you are also a team captain, and you mentioned you do have a few other members who are also survivors on your team. So was it difficult at all to maybe find people to join your team, or was it still fairly easy to convince?
Not at all. It was very easy to find people to join our team, and also we had no problem raising money as well.
And talking about that, raising money, how did you guys actually go about it? And again, it's all going to the Canadian Cancer Society.
Mostly online, mostly through Facebook and social media, just sharing the link and putting my story, and people read it and donated.
And now we also talked a little bit off camera how you actually didn't exactly know what you were signing up for when you joined the Relay for Life. So what are you kind of, I guess, maybe expecting from tonight or hoping to see happen?
I'm just here to have a good time, and hopefully everybody has fun. That's kind of just it.
All right, perfect. Thank you so much once again for joining us. We're going to have a little bit more coming back from here at Bud Miller Park, where Relay for Life Lloydminster is taking place tonight. But first, we are going to go back into the studio.
And here we are back in said studio, wishing we were outside with you guys on this nice warm Lloydminster afternoon. Now becoming an evening, of course. 19 degrees in the border city with a mix of sun and cloud, but largely sun right now, certainly if you're out at Bud Miller. Again, that will kind of continue over the rest of the week, and that will start to clear out a little bit later on in the evening. Record of 28 2 years ago, and then a record of 1 back in 2000. I know which night I would have preferred if I was here in between 2000 and 2017. And just like that, we're now at 20 degrees, so it's warming up here in the border city. Clear skies largely on the Sask side, but could get a little smoggier depending on what happens with these fires. The Lakeland region, as said earlier, has cleared up a little bit, but relatively smoggy throughout the rest of the province, where there's still an air quality statement, not certainly as eerie as it was yesterday, where it almost felt like a post-apocalyptic event with that orange hue, but definitely still smoggy and something to keep an eye out for, especially if you have issues with breathing, particularly if you're an asthmatic or something else like that. And a severe thunderstorm watch also still in effect for the region. And I'll just step out here as we take a look at our other highs and current temperatures throughout the region. You can see there 21 degrees in Vermilion and in Wainwright, as well as in Vegreville and Edmonton. Lloydminster sitting at 20, Cold Lake still at 19 degrees, and North Battleford also sitting at 20, 16 in Isle of Cross. So definitely cooling down over the last hour. And we will look forward to having more weather chatting with you over the next hour, including the 7-day forecast. We'll take a short break. There's your 3-day.
Dale Mitsuing had a rookie campaign for the ages, becoming the first CPCA rookie to win the Dash in August. Now entering the Chuck Wagon season this weekend, looking to defend the title. There's additional goals this summer. Josh Ryan has more.
Dale Mitsuing headed to the wire with his wheels on fire.
Almost 10 months removed from making Chuck Wagon history, Dale Mitsuing says the place he occupies in the sport still feels a bit surreal.
When I did win, I was more so looking forward to the fireworks after the show. I used to sit here as a kid and watch these guys and be like, one day I'm going to be the guy with the fireworks and all that cool intro.
Now that one of his major goals as a driver is complete, Mitsuing is focused on improving his consistency and help bring more exposure to Chuck Wagon racing.
Giving them little tours, meet the horses kind of thing, you know. It's just showing a little more aspect of the sport, and more rather than focusing just on that one goal of driving. because they're the people that actually keep this sport going.
2019 is shaping up to be as equally memorable for the Mitsuing family, with his father Ray competing for the last time. However fun the experience will be, the defending champ still intends on being first across the finish line.
We're all here to compete. That's the sport, right? So if he's ahead of me, I'm going to try to catch him. If I'm ahead of him, I'm going to try and stay ahead of him. So this is just the way it goes.
And along with this season, he has his sights set on an even bigger championship.
Goal is Calgary, and once I get to Calgary, that's where my real test comes.
Josh Ryan, Primetime Local Sports.
The show runs till Sunday evening at the North Battleford Exhibition Grounds. And in his fourth year of the Great Cycle Challenge, Jared Russell continues to push himself on the bike path and off. The child cancer survivor will lead the first ever Family and Friends 5-kilometer bike and walk at Bud Miller on June 2nd. The event, which also has prizes for kids dressed as superheroes, is meant to highlight what Russell has worked to raise more than $90,000 for.
We just changed it up because it's all about the kids, not me doing a golf tournament and riding around a golf cart.
Russell plans to surpass 100,000 and add to his 300 plus kilometers on the bike.
I was in the States for most of the winter, just train and all that. Didn't have bikes outside, but I used inside bikes, like the gyms.
Registration takes place at 4 p.m. Sunday at the picnic shelter. And now we're going to Eric Bay, who's live at Bud Miller Park.
Back here once again at Bud Miller Park, where we are getting closer to 7 p.m., which is the start of this year's Relay for Life that will be going on here tonight. And I'm joined by Brittany Prevot now, who is volunteering this year, but has also participated in the past in the Relay for Life. So can you maybe just talk a little bit about why you've chose Relay for Life to participate in with the past few years?
Basically, everyone knows somebody that has been affected by cancer one way or another, and so it's pretty easy to find enough people to put a team into something like this that it really, everyone feels, you know, emotion about that.
And now, we talked a little bit off camera about how, again, you have participated before, so what have you seen over the years at this event as it's kind of progressed?
Lots of people come out to participate or even just to watch. The luminaries are beautiful at night. The teams usually have like little themes, so you see like a little bit of teamwork, and I like that kind of stuff. Yeah.
And now you did mention too about how you guys couldn't actually get a team in this year, so you chose to volunteer. So why was it so important to still be involved this year in this year's Relay for Life?
I like being able to be involved in the community. I believe that you should always be giving back to community if you want the community to be giving back to you. So it was just important to me to be able to do something for Relay for Life one way or another. I've lost a grandmother to cancer and an uncle and, you know, various other things with cancer. So it's just important to me to be involved in something that's affecting our community in a positive way.
And again, you've been here a few times. So what would you say to people if you were encouraging to come out? What is something that they'd actually have to come out to experience?
Just to come out to experience how our community comes together for one night. And obviously cancer affects people in all different ways. Some people survive cancer and some people don't. There's all different types of cancer, but this is for everyone, right? So there's lots of different foundations for like one certain type of cancer, but this is for everybody. So it's a real community of survivors and their caregivers and all of that. So it's just a really special night where everybody is welcome for this. Yeah.
All right, thank you so much for joining us. We're gonna have a little bit more back from here, but first we'll go back into the studio.
You get outside, but we'll have a chance to later on this evening, as I'm sure many of you are on your way outside soon. Just make sure if you do go outside, there is still a warning in place, not here on the Saskatchewan side, but on the Alberta side, as you can see, a little bit smoky in several areas, aside from the Lakeland region, which has largely been clear. Thunderstorm warning, again, in effect for later in the week. Now, as you can see with these current temperatures, 19 degrees in Cold Lake, 21 in Edson, 19 out in Jasper, and 20 in Rocky Mountain House. Whitecourt at 19 degrees. So things starting to cool down a little bit out in Alberta, whereas on the Saskatchewan side, it's a similar situation with 19 in Prince Albert, 18 in Melfort, and just 20 degrees in Saskatoon as well. Everything dropping by a degree or so outside of here in the Midwest, where a couple of the communities have actually gone up a degree or two since 6 o'clock. Now, as we back out and look at North Battleford, it was slightly cooler earlier at 19 degrees. It's now at 20 with wind coming out of the north-northwest, 18 kilometers per hour. That will drop down to about 9 kilometers overnight and jump back up to 15 tomorrow. 7 degrees, the overnight low, 26 the high for the afternoon out in the Battlefords. Cold Lake, similar situation at 19 degrees, dropping to 8, bouncing right back up to 26 as the wind shifts to the southeast. Relatively calm skies there at the moment. In Lloydminster, again, we were sitting at about 18 degrees when we started the first hour of the show at 5 o'clock, and since then we've gone up to 20, so a very warm evening indeed, with just a little bit of wind chill out of the west to take the edge off for those who don't like too much sun. 10 kilometers coming again out of the west. Southeast winds will be similar wind speeds, and then 9 degrees overnight, followed by 27 tomorrow with south winds coming at around 17 kilometers. So again, looking forward to relatively clear skies, though there is a chance that we could see some precipitation later in the week, as much as 40% on Sunday, though that does give you an excuse on Sunday instead to make sure that you simply go out and you enjoy the Raptors game, whether it's from the comfort of your own home or out at some establishment in this fine border city. That's it for me now. We'll have a short break and have more on Primetime Local News.
Now we're going to Eric Bay, who's live at Bud Miller Park.
Thanks, guys. Once again, we are back here at Bud Miller Park, where Relay for Life is going here in just a little bit. And I'm joined now by a couple more volunteers, Amro and Dustin. And now, Amro, this is your first year actually volunteering. So can you maybe talk about why you want to get involved here this year?
Yeah, it's my first year volunteering with the event. It's a cause that touches pretty much everyone. Whether it's someone close to you or someone that you know of. So I felt that this is an opportunity that I can participate and give back to the cause, a great cause.
Awesome. And now, Dustin, this is actually your fourth year, you mentioned off camera. Yes. So can you talk about how you actually originally got involved in it?
I got involved with a really good friend of mine. She was running a booth over there, and I didn't really know what Relay Life was about, or For Life was about until then. And then once I was done helping out at the booth, I came over here and just started helping out, and realized it was such a great cause and I'd want to come back.
Awesome. And now you have mentioned again, it's been your fourth year. So what have you seen over the years as it's kind of progressed, the response from the community at this event?
The best thing is seeing new teams come out. Like, for example, today there's a brand new team. I believe it's something like 24 members in it. So I think it's just awesome reaching different parts of the community, different organizations, and just seeing that support.
And now for yourself, Amro, this being your first year, what are you kind of expecting from this experience tonight, from people coming out here and participating?
Well, I'm hoping for a good turnout. It's a beautiful day today, so hopefully to see the community come out and support this cause and make it a great event for everyone.
And now, Dustin, just real quick here, as we are running out of time, you being the veteran of the group here, if there's anything you could talk about here tonight that would encourage people, maybe one thing that they'd have to come out and check out, what would you say it'd be?
So I think a big part of it is cancer affects everybody. So just coming out and supporting it, I think that's great. Some incentives as well are there's going to be live music there, and it's just a gorgeous day. Like, it's the best one we've seen in a lot of years. So just come out and just check it out.
All right. Thank you guys so much once again for joining us. We're going to have a little bit more back from here, but first we'll go back into the studio.
Question of the day, which has been near and dear to many foodies' hearts, I'm sure. What summer food were you looking forward to this summer? Now, we got a couple of comments we wanted to single out. Rick Kloss says, slow roasted barbecue turkey injected with Louisiana hot sauce. So really wants to put your mouth and insides on fire with that one. And then Amy Levesque added, marshmallows roasted over the campfire. Pretty common response, but notably, when there is no fire ban. So that is one thing to keep in mind when we have these wildfires going on and it's so dry. We do have a fire ban generally in place. So that's something to keep an eye on, certainly with the city Twitter and other notices about whether or not it's too dry for fires, and you want to be certainly careful about that. I love a good barbecue, but no burger is worth Lloydminster lighting up, so to speak.
Yeah, then no, that's definitely fair. I'm excited for the summer, and I hope the ban doesn't go on for too long, because you know that kind of dampers camping plans and you know staying outside, just having a fire with your friends. So hopefully the ban doesn't stick around for too long or anything like that. But
yeah, and I don't think we will have to worry about it potentially, because we could get some precipitation later this week and weekend. So especially on Sunday, there's a good chance you can be inside during the Raptors game while it pours outside. So we'll see if that precipitation chance drops up or down. Something that has never dropped down on people's attention spans is, of course, Pet of the Day, the most looked forward to segment of the show. And Dolce, thanks to
Adorable
Wendy
dog.
Turner, is our first entrant, who clearly is enjoying being indoors as opposed to the great outdoors. Next up, we have Chris Ridgewell's Duke, who is enjoying the outdoors and likely is at some barbecue or another, just likes to be around people, clearly.
Very cute.
Gus, speaking of cute, from Maureen Lundquist Hart, joining in on the Spider-Man look from 2002. That really did seem to catch on for some reason. Moving on now to Sasha, who
very majestic.
Really, really keenly and proudly looking over her kingdom. Thank you, Brooke. And next up here, we have Iris to round things off. So Kirsten, Alyssa, thank you for that
very adorable
submission.
Bunny.
Iris, not quite as proud a pet, but no doubt as cute.
Yes.
And always remember, if you submit a picture of your pet with the name, you can win a gift card from PetPat.
We want to see your pets. Send photos of your pet and their name to our Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram to have them featured on Pet of the Day. Your name will be entered into a weekly draw for a gift certificate from the PetPat.
I have a very special guest joining me in studio today, and as you can see by these beautiful works of art, this is Kayla from Paintings by Kayla. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
So I want to talk a little bit about, there's so many different beautiful paintings that you've done here, but how did you get into it?
So basically, my granny used to be an artist. She painted all kinds of things, and when she passed away, we were going through some old stuff and we came across her paints and brushes, and art was always something that I enjoyed in school. I never really was into painting though, but one night I just found her things and kind of just painted something with them, and I found it as like a therapy, and people were really into it. I posted on one of the Lloydminster online sales and people told me to make a page, so I did. And it kind of just went from there.
Now, right beside us or between us here, we have two, these are custom pet portraits.
Yes.
So you said they're becoming very popular?
Yeah, that was something I actually just started doing probably about 6 months ago. I had a request for somebody to paint, or for me to paint a dog for somebody that their pet had passed away. And I was just getting into watercolors at that point, so I was kind of experimenting. And yeah, I actually really enjoyed doing it, and they were really happy with it, so I just kind of picked up on it from there, and they've been a very popular choice just for gifts, even for people that have had pets that passed away. But yeah, so I quite enjoy doing those.
And if somebody wants to order that, or even for a pet that they have, it's still with them that they'd like to display in their home.
Yeah,
like
there's actually been
do.
Quite a few people that have had pets still alive and just want to show them off.
Yeah, so what's a charge for that? What do
so
you usually charge?
So for the pet portraits, I typically charge $120 in that. Is on the 14 by 14 canvas, and that includes the frame, which everything I do is hand cut and stained and everything. So everything is fully customizable.
Wow.
Sizes, everything can be customized to colors, everything.
Right.
So, yeah.
And now talk about the ones you have in front of us there. We've got
So
the cow.
Yeah, the cow. Those ones are always popular too. Yeah. It's also watercolor. So I kind of got into watercolors, and I really enjoy doing kinds of animals, nursery art, just farm animals and zoo animals. They're just super fun to paint and people seem to love them. The florals I also say would be really popular. And also like my script, that's something that I've always learned freehand. Mm-hmm. I know there's certain tools you can get to vinyl them on and stuff. I didn't even know you could do that, so I kind of just learned the hard way and just did it on my own. But
And are is everyone a custom order, or are some ones that you just get inspiration for?
There's times where I just find inspiration and I paint, but mm-hmm. for the most part, I'm too busy with custom orders to right. do it on my own for fun. But yeah, it's been very busy, which is awesome, because there's been tons of support, and I've shipped all over Canada
wow.
and some in the US, which is pretty cool. But yeah, it's very busy with custom orders. It never seems to slow down, especially around the holidays and stuff.
Right, nice gifts for somebody.
Ideas. Yeah, exactly.
So if somebody wants to get more information or have a look at some of the paintings, some of the work that mm-hmm. you've done previously, what is the best way to kind of find that all in one place?
Facebook or Instagram.
Okay.
So my Facebook page is kind of where I started, and then mm-hmm. I went on Instagram not too long after.
Okay.
Sometimes on my Instagram stories, I'll have like polls and stuff if mm-hmm. I'm looking for opinions on if I'm doing a stock and I want to know what people want to see.
Yeah.
Or sometimes they'll get first glances at stuff that I'm making. But yeah, usually Facebook is the best way to get a hold of me.
Okay.
Yeah.
And just message you and go from there.
Yeah, pretty much. I don't have a website or anything, but.
Right. Well, sometimes it's just as easy to show you stuff the other ways too.
I tried doing Etsy, and I just found it was too much work to make listings, and it's just easier for people to get on me through Facebook.
Yeah, and if you're busy, that's great. So.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for joining us today. Yeah. Your work is absolutely beautiful.
Thank you so much.
And I hope that you have continued success with this project. Yeah. So thank you once again.
Thank you so much.
Hey, I'm Justin with Boom 101.9 and 93.7 Win FM, and here's what's happening. This week, Fast and Curious moves over to another location. Now, we're getting to the nitty-gritty of it. We're giving the car away June 8th, so you only have 2 more weeks to enter to qualify. Monday morning at 7:40 a.m., we call a qualifier's name. This week, if you want to enter, head over to First Choice Auto Detailing in Lloydminster. That's where the vehicle is. That's where you can take a picture with it, fall in love, and who knows, hopefully, we call your name. Now, there is a catch. If we do call your name, you only have 370 seconds to call us back. So if you have entered or if you plan on entering, make sure you and everyone you know is listening Monday morning, because you do not want to miss that cue to call. Full schedule details on all that can be found over at 1019boom.com and at waynefm.com. Moving over to another event that's happening in Wainwright, Alberta Health Services presents HeartWise for those that want to learn more about managing blood pressure and cholesterol. Now, they have 2 sessions. The first one will be going down June 10th, and the second will be June 24th at the Wainwright Primary Care Network. And then even more stuff is going down. Now, you're gonna wanna register for this one right away, because it is gonna fill up quick. That is why I'm giving you so much notice. The 33rd annual IRMA Summer Spiel is happening July 30th to August 5th. There's gonna be curling, a slow pitch tournament, and a whole bunch of other fantastic events filled with great people. Like I said, that one's gonna fill up quick, so you wanna get on top of that right now. If you wanna check out registration forms, you can go over to irmasummerspiel.com for all that stuff. I'm Justin with 101.9 Boom and 93.7 Wayne FM, and that's what's happening.
Furniture supplied by Furniture Gallery and Furniture House, downtown Lloydminster.
Today I'm joined here with Brianna. She is the chair of the Lloydminster Youth Council, and today we're going to be talking about a little event that's coming up called Border Dash. Thank you for joining me today.
Thank you for having me.
And explaining this event. So where did the idea of the Border Dash come from?
So this is the 3rd annual Border Dash. It started with the first group, and they wanted to have like a race style event for kids in the spring, and we were inspired kind of by Amazing Race and doing small challenges within a competitive race, and there came Border Dash.
And how does it work like with the different age groups that participate?
So this year we have grades 7 to 9, our junior category, and then we have our senior category, grades 10 to 12. So the juniors start at 10 a.m. and the race lasts about 45 minutes to an hour, and then the seniors start at 12 noon.
And is there different obstacles and events that they have to do, or is it just like a running race?
So there are different challenges and obstacles. We have, I think it's 7 events placed throughout the park this year. So It is a competition based on fastest time, but you have to complete all of those smaller mini challenges to finish the race.
And when does the Border Dash start?
So it is on this Sunday, June 2nd. The juniors, the grades 7 to 9, start at 10 a.m. and the seniors, grades 10 to 12, start at 12 p.m.
And how can kids get involved in the race?
So we have our registration forms out on our Facebook page. So themselves or their parents can check out the Lloydminster Youth Council on Facebook as well as on Instagram.
And will it, like, obviously, if you, this is the third year, it's been really successful. How does this year differ from the two previous years?
So the first year we did it, we tried it in a smaller area in Bud Miller, and then last year we hosted it here in downtown Lloydminster. So this year it's bigger, there's more obstacles, and it's a bit more widespread throughout the park.
And will the obstacles be different, let's say, next year? How do you think you'll be changing it up for the next year?
So we have a few that we like to keep. We do a murder mystery every year. It's a fun little challenge for people to do, but every year we like to switch it up depending on what that council of that year comes up with.
And have you received a lot of feedback from the students that have participated in previous years?
Yeah, Border Dash is actually one of the events that inspired me to join the Lloydminster Youth Council. I participated with three of my friends the first year that they had it, and I had a blast. It is so much fun, and every year we get so much positive feedback from other students saying, like, I'm so glad I joined this. Like, it's such a great time to spend, like, an hour or two with your friends.
And I guess going off of, like, the friends, can if a group of people come in the same age group, will they get to race together or participate together? Or do you kind of separate people that come into different groups?
Yeah, so we have registration open for teams of two as well as teams of four, because we've had previous years where we've done teams of four, and we've had previous years that we've done teams of two, and this year we want to open it up to both.
All right, well, thank you for coming in and explaining Border Dash, and if you or anyone you know would like to participate, it is happening this Sunday at Bud Miller Park, and registration is, you can find it on their Facebook page.
Yes.
At Lloydminster.
Yep.
Youth Council.
Yes.
Yep. So thank you for coming in.
Thank you for having me.
Thanks.
Back here once again at Bud Miller Park, and we are getting closer here to 7 o'clock, which is in Relay for Life. We'll be starting here tonight. You can maybe hear the music in the background. They've started that up. The band is unloading their drum kit right in front of me now. So if you want to come out, check out some Relay for Life, you can definitely do so. Again, those opening ceremonies will be starting here at about 7 o'clock, where they will also be honoring the survivors as they walk out, and then actually starting the Relay for Life relay. And if you maybe didn't get a team in and do still want to come out and support, you can also buy a candle and have those lit up as well. Those are on sale until 9:30, and check those out. They're only $5. Again, showing your support and raising money for cancer awareness. So that's all from us this week. Have a great weekend, and now we'll go back into the studio where Josh and Abby will wrap up tonight's newscast.
Thanks very much, Eric. 27 degrees Saturday, then 28 degrees on Sunday, where we might get some rain right around the time that the Raptors take place in game two. Monday, 24 degrees, and then things cool down to 22 on Tuesday, 18 Wednesday, 17 Thursday, and 20 on Friday. Again, a few other days with a chance of precipitation, particularly Wednesday with a 61% chance. As we were talking about earlier, Abby, maybe we kind of need a little bit of precipitation.
Yeah.
Wouldn't hurt.
Yeah, it'd definitely be beneficial.
Yeah. And you know what's very beneficial to all you pet lovers out there? Our pet board, pet pad winner of the day, or winner of the week, I should say. Let's do it.
Aww.
And look at that.
I love
it. Cattle riding chihuahua is on top. Evie.
Love it.
You are our winner. Bailey Cameron, you get that gift card from Pet Pad. I still want to know what they're doing in the tub, unless it was a photo shoot. But yeah, congratulations to Evie, a deserving winner, even though the winner is selected at random. But
yes.
Still, deserving winner nonetheless.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's been a fun week.
Oh, definitely.
Doing this. Gotta make sure we get outside and enjoy this weather a little bit.
Oh, definitely.
So, yeah. And with that, we will leave you. Once again, stay indoors if it gets pouring on Sunday. Watch the air quality if you're asthmatic. And have a great weekend, everyone in the area.